1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 27, 30, 49.
But Murphy said it doesn't matter.
Okay, folks, if I could get everybody to take their seats, we're going to get back in session here. If I could get everybody to take their seats, we're going to get back into session. Please take your seats. Session and moving us on to our next agenda item, which is agenda item 5, comprehensive plan. I'm going to suggest, I guess, that we pick up where we left off, review the language of the first goal and objectives that we reviewed last time, which is again was goal live 3, objective live 3.1 and 3.2. We can review the language that staff has come back with and then continue on down the list unless we think we have a better process at that point. So I guess I'd open it up for feedback on what staff has recommended for rewrites of 3, 3.1, and 3.2. If you don't mind, I'll go around Robin on it, starting with Rita.
Actually, live 3.1, capitalize on opportunities for redevelopment associated with obsolescent land uses in proximity to major transportation investments. And who decides what obsolescent land uses are? And is, I guess, the major thing here is it is going to be in industrial areas, because that's where the main transportation corridor is. And my number one concern is how will this affect our industrial areas? Where will we relocate industrial areas to maintain opportunities for work within the city of Englewood? And how can we make certain that the industrial areas will be protected? Those are my major concerns.
Thank you. Steve? Thank you, Amy.
I am fine with the revisions as is.
Thank you. Linda, sorry.
I don't know why I find it funny to call them enhanced relationships to land use and transportation, but I guess
right now it's primarily the private sector that's demanding development opportunities in the industrial area, especially around the light rail station at Oxford. There is some pressure around this station, but not nearly as much as the Oxford station. And the private sector is pushing that right now.
For residential use, mostly?
Yes.
Go ahead, Rita. Oh, sorry. Man, I'm bad at this.
I'm a kinder gentler Rick.
Look at that. I'm impressed. You know, the relationships are doing so much better.
You know, and I don't mean to answer Rita's question about the obsolescence, who defines it. I think society defines obsolescence. Great example of that would be the Hilltop. That is an obsolete. We would never want to agree with that. That to me would mean we need to look at instances of that to say that's probably not where we want to go forward with. We would want to redo some of that and kind of hopefully bring in some new ideas. So other than that comment, I'm fine with the wording. And I think there's a difference between obsolescence and land uses versus functional obsolescence, which I think you don't understand the term being a real estate guy, is how things work within buildings. I don't think we're looking at functional obsolescence, but Hilltop is the perfect obsolescent example, in my opinion.
Thank you. Go back to Rita.
And I actually agree with Rick on that. However, when you look at industrial areas, a lot of people would say it's all obsolescent. So, I mean, that becomes an issue, I believe. And in response to what Harold says about the private sector putting pressure to develop there, by the light rail station on Oxford, if you can find a parking place on Windermere between Oxford and Kenyon, where are we going to put parking places for all of this? Plus, keep parking so that people can visit the businesses that are down there. I think parking could become a huge issue.
You know, just to respond to the parking issue, I totally agree. I mean, you know, keep in mind that it was always kind of envisioned as a park and ride, or kiss and ride, I suppose, without a parking facility there. You know, RTD is still sort of on the hook through Fast Tracks, I believe, for 400 some odd additional spots for the Southwest Corridor. Unfortunately, we as a council, I think, have not identified a location that is palatable for us to where they could expend those funds to provide that free parking. You remember we looked at the expansion of the existing lot here at Inglewood City Center north towards Dartmouth that met some resistance from the neighborhood for parkland type of issues, and we have never gotten back to them as far as where that location might be. And so if we did identify a spot around there, we could alleviate some of that congestion, but you know, it's I don't know what the solution exactly is there, but the problem is we'd have to buy a lot, and the problem with a structure, of course, is that it's, you know, very cost prohibitive. Instead of getting 400 spots, we might only get 100 spots, something like in that realm. You know, I wanted to say the quote they gave us for per spot on structured parking was like $30,000+. It was unbelievable. Yeah, unbelievably cost prohibitive. So, just wanted to speak a little bit on the parking there. You know, and I think that when it comes to industrial versus, you know, higher density residential along the corridor there, I think we need to have some language there to suggest to future councils and others that, you know, there needs to be a substantial, you know, consideration given to
the comments that's been used, or statements that's been used a lot in the community, is best use. As the quality, or I should say, as the character of the community changes, then its best use, the property's best use, kind of changes over time. It's, as an example, here on Broadway, as we get better quality businesses in there, and I want to be careful how I say better quality, but businesses that are in higher demand, that encourages more businesses to come. When it comes to, especially over there by Oxford, the best use along the light rail is going to be higher density. It's just the way it is nationwide. Can't fight it. Well, we can fight it, but it's futile. And when it comes to telling somebody who owns that property, no, you can't do a higher density housing. We're kind of telling them the same thing as if somebody has a, you know, historical home. Well, you can't do the home improvement because we don't like it. As long as it's within the zoning, they have the right to do what they're doing. Now, when it comes to parking, I think as a city, there's ways that we can handle that, especially over there in that business district. First of all, we start putting some time limits on parking, 2 hours. Then for the businesses that are there, they can get some permitting for their employees and, or whatever need be.
On the street, correct?
On the street, right. So that we encourage people not to just go there and park all day. Because that's what's happening. So there's ways we can be creative about resolving that. And yes, concentration or the amount of people that are going to be parking there is going to go up. It's, I hate to say it, but it's inevitable. So we need to be creative as a city on how do we manage that. Now, when it comes to industrial areas like on the hill, I don't think, and I could be wrong about this, but I don't think it's going to be in such high demand to do high-density housing. I think it's going to stay more industrial, which I strongly encourage. We need that business base within our community. Now, how do we keep it from changing from business to higher-density housing? I'm not really sure, because that's the way it's zoned right now. They can do that. As community development, we can encourage mixed use, so at least we keep that bottom floor, you know, businesses. I don't know how well that would work with residential housing on the hill, but it would allow some of these businesses that have been there, they could actually, if they're able to build a few floors and get rental property and get their property worth more and makes more generation, potentially they could help fund the growth that they need within their business. There's a lot of ways of being creative here. I do agree with everyone that we need to keep it as industrial as much as possible, but we also have to realize residents are coming.
If you don't mind, I got a couple questions. Like Martin Plastics is a PUD, correct? And they were industrial prior to going to a PUD.
They were.
So they saw a major benefit in not just going with the industrial zoning they had, but switching it to PUD, correct?
They wanted to make it a family-friendly or neighborhood-oriented place. They're placemaking, and they've been long-time people there. So
can make more money for their land. But when they bought that land, it was industrial, and we have the choice of whether or not we want to change it. Now, here's the problem that we're facing is Sports Authority was the second largest employer in Englewood. If we get rid of that space, we're eliminating the opportunity for another employer to come in here that would have the room to expand to that degree. And we have control as long as we maintain the industrial areas. And it is a choice of the council and of the citizens of this city to choose how we want to go. Just because more density is coming, we don't have to have it in Englewood. It's going to impact us because we're surrounded through the main corridors. But it is our choice. It's not that it's coming and we just have to, oh, it's coming and there's nothing we can do. I don't believe that.
You know, going to that Sports Authority, I'll get you in just a second here. Going to that Sports Authority site, I mean, I do recall when I was younger, that was retail, you know, and home base or something. Some use by right things in industrial zones versus PUDs, and what, you know, where the rubber really met the road as far as what Martin Plastics had the ability to do use by right versus through that PUD process. Because, you know, my inclination, at least initially, is that, you know, the owners there have the control of what's going to be happening at that site future. But, you know, maybe I need a better understanding of where the rubber meets the road as far as what is possible there without our consent by use by right. And real quickly on the parking piece, you know, on Broadway we have two-hour parking now. Unfortunately, it's just not really enforced. We just don't have parking enforcement outside of the city center area. And so that's something that would be a little bit of a cost if we move towards enforcement. I mean, we could put up signs and we like we have on Broadway. I just know that it's just not really enforced. I had a neighboring business who had some concerns about it, and it was just difficult to get some enforcement on it. And now I'm not hearing anybody clamoring for enforcement along Broadway, so I'm not suggesting that. I'm just suggesting that we move towards that. The enforcement piece might be missing a little bit. I'm going to go to Steve and then Lorette.
Okay. I'll address what you just said there about enforcement. If we don't do anything, we have the same problem. If we don't try to resolve it. And if there is truly a demand in these areas to do this, then, you know, we need to look, are we staffing our police department appropriately? So I'm not in favor of not doing anything. So now I lost my train of thought on the other part.
I'll come back to you after Lorette.
Yeah.
She'll probably
go ahead.
Key something for you anyway. Go ahead.
Part of the lawsuit with the Grove right now down in Littleton, and they're discussing the use by right quite a bit, is that it's got to be used by right within the zoning that's allowed in there. And so I've been following that pretty closely. I do think that we need to get a little bit more understanding about these phrases being kicked around as if some phrase just allows somebody to do whatever the hell they want to do on whatever property they own. That's not what use by right means. And so we do need to get a little bit more understanding about that. And if you take some time to follow especially the last council meeting in Littleton and this lawsuit that's happening, of course, which has more to do with who heard the appeal and them denying them the ability to hear that. But it's brought up all of this issue, and their mix of commercial and residential, and the use of the word subdivision being a combination of projects instead of the word subdivision there. I mean, Peggy Cole is an ex-dean, English department. She gave everybody quite a thorough understanding of the word subdivision doesn't mean combine. So if they're going to be arguing about things like that over this whole use by right thing, maybe we don't want to get into that quagmire and come to some understanding about what all of this means prior to doing it and why people go to a PUD rather than going ahead and going with the zoning that's on there. We do. And we need to take care of the parking before. We're putting potentially around 500 souls in one project alone with Martin Plastics, and then we're going to think about the parking. We're going to go ahead and start writing tickets. And we put all of these people down there with only 1.3 cars per unit, right next to a Kiss and Ride in an industrial area, and then we're going to go ahead and go, okay, now we're going to ticket you, but we didn't address any parking stuff, and there's another project that's set to go back in that area. No, people are not happy with this in an area that we already had a parking issue with. And the reason we know it was a parking issue is because Martin Plastics was supposed to be a parking lot. RTD had it scheduled as one of the overflow lots that they were going to give us some of the, that and Sam's Automotive was on a plan 4 or 5 years ago to be part of the solution to the parking problem. And instead, we put people down there and more cars, and it certainly didn't take care of any parking issue. So certainly, either the developer has to pay for it. What I'm hearing from the community is we have to make sure that those things are taken care of prior to putting any projects in there. And if we don't have the availability for the parking and shove more souls down there, then we shouldn't ought to be doing it. We shouldn't be doing it. And the people who are currently in this community are not interested in paying for the infrastructure for developers. They're going to have to pay for development. If those kind of amenities need to be taken care of for the density that they're putting in there, then they have to shoulder that cost. Not the people in this community right now. They're not interested in doing that. But we already see a lot of problems coming from the lack of planning on the couple of ones that have been done along that area, and we need to make sure that we don't add more to the problem. But I do agree with you that we need to have some more information going in with these, because some of these phrases are getting thrown around as if they don't mean anything, or as if that gives somebody all the power, and it doesn't. As to Rita's point, it will only happen if we allow it. There is no predetermination. Nobody else controls us. This is a home rule city. We're independent. We make our rules for our city. And so this throwing it to the wind and acting like we have no control or no power on behalf of the people that elected us is I don't know, it's just ridiculous. We are going through the comp plan. We do the zoning. We make the decisions based on hopefully representing our constituency on where the future of this goes. And it won't happen if we don't allow it. So I just hope that if it does go through any more of this, that we start taking care of the very serious problems that are happening with that kind of density, and be realistic about what we're creating and the problems we're creating and the cost of those problems. That's all I had.
Come back to Steve, and I'll go to Linda.
Okay. It's probably, you know, Lorette makes a good point. We probably should make sure we all understand the definition of these words, because you can go to the English dictionary, look up a definition, and then go to a law dictionary, and they're totally two different things. So it's very important that we do understand exactly what these words mean from a legal standpoint or a lawful standpoint, depending on the subject. Higher density. Has anybody read this report that was sent out from them? It's actually quite interesting about these trends of what happens in these higher density communities. And we're going to see more people. We're going to see more things in these higher densities. But will they react the same way as a standalone home? And in this report, they make a very good point that these communities act differently. So as we're looking at this whole subject, we need to take in consideration that the higher density communities along the light rail is not a duck. We need to look at it for what it really is. The other thing is, as we go through this, and assuming I understand what use by right is and downzoning, one of the things I ran on was protecting people's personal property rights. And yes, council can come down and make all these rules and change people's property rights, but you're gonna have kickback on that. And potentially we will find ourselves in court, and just simply because, you know, somebody that's on the other side of town doesn't like the idea of higher density along the right light rail does not necessarily mean that council has the right to take something from that property owner along the light rail because someone else doesn't like it. This is a republic. So we need to treat it as it's a republic.
Thank you. Linda, right?
Do you all know what he was talking about with the study that
yes.
he sent us? Did everybody read it? I think it's worth really taking a look at it. I think there are a lot of myths. The Urban Land Institute, many other land institutes have been producing studies like this over and over, saying very similar things. So I think we need to be open to the possibility that what we want or like isn't necessarily what happens and what's true. But on the other one, I wanted to make a comment about we have never... No one has ever just done whatever they wanted to when it wasn't right by use. It's always the staff have always noted when there needed to be something to adjust for a PUD or something like that. And the PUD comes before several bodies, and there is a process. So there is a process in place for making these changes. And every council in the future, it's seven people. They have to decide together whether they're going to do it or not, and that's how it's always been done. That is how it changes. So if you don't want it in the future, then say no. I don't know what the issue is other than, you know, I mean, people over in my neighborhood never wanted Kent Place, you know, but the council was seven and they put it through. They could have, by right, put up 14-story buildings with no PUD at all and had three or four shadowing all over the place there. So it's a different complex now. Everybody's adjusted, but I think it's a little different kind of thing there than what, I mean, there are a lot of places like that could go up. We know that. One of the areas by the medical district was like that, and we actually did. Downsize it. Could have gone lots of right by use into the air.
Yeah.
So there are places like that maybe it would be good to do a zoning sort of overview for everybody to say, where are our neighborhoods that are at risk again? And do we want to protect them in some way or not? Or are we okay with it just staying the way it is?
I just wanted to clarify the use by right and the PUD are two different things.
Right.
So when they were... Okay. So when they were talking about the use by right, as if they had the ability to do whatever they wanted on it, I didn't say that there wasn't a process for a PUD. And the PUD for the old seminary property would have been four-story apartments is what they could have done without a PUD going in there. What they did for the PUD was to go ahead and get that height and that extra density in there with nothing, no zoning change at all. It was already okay for them to do four-story apartments in there, not the retail and the mix that they ended up doing. The original plan that came through had the different condos and the houses and stuff, and that's when they, the townhouses around in the condos, but that's when they did the height. They could have never done this 14-story building prior to that. It was only something similar to what you would see on Bellevue. Once that PUD got put in there, then, and they switched it over, the PUD stayed, the rezone stayed, the upzone stayed, the higher density stayed, the project went away that got done, and then they had that right after the PUD went in there, and that's why I would encourage that if we ever did a PUD again, that changed the zoning like that, similar to what happened to Inglewood Estates, once they were three lots and then they got a PUD and moved them to seven, then that stayed even though the plan that got them the seven moved away. And I would suggest one of the things we should put through to zoning or have on our ordinances is that once a PUD happens under a specific project or an upzoning happens on a specific project, if that project that got approved doesn't happen, then the zoning reverts back to what it was. But had that Kent Place zoning reverted back to what it was originally, would have never been 14-story buildings that they were allowed to do. That's not what the original from the seminary to that would have been. So once you get down that slippery slope, that's what I'm talking about, is once you get down that slippery slope, a whole community gets sold on a project, and they say, look at how beautiful it is. It's gorgeous. It's everything. They get the upzoning. They get the PUD. The project goes away, but this upzoning stays, and that's what we would like to see stop.
It was my understanding from the beginning that they always had a height ability that property had, and I don't know if our community development people
not from
can
the,
remember
not from
that.
Seminary
that it was
to
rezoned
that.
For a number of other things, but I might be wrong. That was what was told to the neighbors.
Not at, well, it was a long process, but But from the seminary process to that, it wouldn't have been.
You know, I think you're right. I mean, I think what's happening is, you know, a lot of these developers come with a project that they think they have in mind. They want to gain the entitlement so that they can market it, gain their financing, these other things. And sometimes the market changes, and sometimes, you know, things change. And so, you know, I think you're noting that sometimes is a positive or a negative. And in my mind, you know, in allowing them to have those entitlements and shop that project around, you know, netted in an end result of a beautiful development over at Kemp Place. And so, you know, I feel like that's a net positive for us and worked out well. You know,
I guess all I'm asking is if we could bring that up in the future.
Sure.
Because it's nothing like what was originally proposed over there that got them that upzoning. And what I've seen now in Centennial and in Littleton especially, with several arguments going on, and what's happened to us as well with this Kent Place and was tried on a small scale with the Inglewood Estates thing, is that you buy a property, you upzone it, you get this PUD thing, and then you never move a shovel full of dirt. But all of a sudden, the property that you have is worth a lot more because you've gotten it upzoned, and that's all that they intended to do in the first place. So we have to make sure that the picture that sells our community on upzoning or higher density is the picture that gets built, not what ended up happening at Kent Place, because I'm telling you that other picture was more,
fair
way
enough,
more gorgeous.
Fair enough. And I all I'm
so
pointing
I just
out,
want to discuss
yeah,
it
all I'm saying
point.
Is that, you know, I agree with you in that sometimes the vision that they point to us is sometimes changed through to market resources, reactions, and other things. You know, I know that we're getting a little bit off topic here, but I do appreciate the conversation, as I felt like we needed kind of a kickoff on dealing with a lot of issues that folks want to talk about. I guess I'm going to ask staff about the industrial use by right versus this PUD. Do you think any of you could kind of set us straight on some of that, or do you want to kind of delve into that a little bit on the next meeting? Like, what could somebody in an I-1 or I-2 build as far as high-density residential use by right versus the PUD, and why did, you know, Martin Plastics go through a PUD, and what additional benefits did they receive through that process?
Residential is not a permitted use in the I-1 or I-2 zone district, so in order to do a development like that, the property owner or developer would have to approach the city to affect a rezoning. It could be a rezoning to another zone district that would allow high density.
Or a PUD.
Or a PUD, but there are requirements for of proximity to similar districts if you wanted to rezone it to an R3, for instance. So a PUD is a specialized district that allows an applicant to put together a set of regulations specific for a particular development.
And I guess I was under the impression that in industrial you had some use by right for some residential use, and that you're saying that's not the case.
No, it's not the case.
Okay. But in MUB2, that is the case, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
That's why I would.
That's
I would
a
like to
yeah.
Be
that's a change in what my understanding
yeah.
was there. So, does anybody feel like they need additional clarification on some of that stuff, or you know that we can ask specific questions for staff for next time, or maybe just ask Harold right off the cuff here? He's our resident expert here.
I'm not comfortable with that. Having attended a bunch of meetings lately, I
just one thing. I'd like to do a council request. When it comes to, like, the properties of Kimco and those over here, there seems to be some confusion as to can they just do business or can they do a mixed use or can they do just residential? That maybe we need to have our little map with our zoning and a little key that shows this can be residential, commercial, blah, blah, blah. So we all can figure this out fairly quickly because, frankly, zoning is one of those things that I don't necessarily try to figure out all the time, and it can get pretty complicated. So.
And I think the area you're describing is that MURB 2 that I was questioning there and whether or not there was some use by right residential, and I think we heard the answer was yes, but is there something more specific?
No, just in general, because the conversations that I'm hearing out there, there's a lot of confusion among council members and also among the residents of Inglewood as to what can happen where.
And I will admit to my confusion regarding industrial, and that's
with
why
current
I clarified
zoning.
That.
Sorry.
With current zoning, yeah, that's why I clarified that, I feel like. And so are you basically asking for, like, an anecdotal kind of description of each zone district?
Just in general sort of thing. And, you know, it might be, and I'm going to just say, maybe a triangle, blue triangle means residential or whatever, you know, and just kind of drop them into our zoning and so we can say yay, nay quickly.
Does council agree that we should just move on to 4 and 4.1 and 4.5 at this point, or do you feel like this process is working okay? I see some heads nodding, so I'm going to move on to Goal Live 4, which again is improve community quality of life through complete neighborhood design and neighborhood identity, and Objective 4.1. Improve neighborhood identity through the incorporation of thematic designs and materials into new public improvements. And 4.5, ensure a range of desirable amenities such as recreation, retail, and quality housing in all neighborhoods through zoning reforms where appropriate. And again, I guess I'll just go round robin on this. Amy, you want to pick this one up?
Well, I was distracted.
Okay. Sorry, feel free to pass. I'll come back to you.
About the only thing that I have any issues with is the word complete. And I realize this is a general sort of statement. I just don't think that we should lock it down so tight that it doesn't allow for a little bit of creativity, potential new uses as time comes on. We don't want to pigeonhole ourselves like we did with Trolley Square or Trolley Center, whatever it was, on Broadway, where it just didn't work. And we had committed so many resources towards it that the city lost a lot of money. And so that's the only real thing that I want to say there. And I am very much in favor of parks and recreation. I am in favor of having art in the community. It's just a matter of how do we go about doing it, you know. So there you go.
Appreciate those comments. Thank you. Rita?
Are they
penalties for the following reason, is that nothing's going to happen or change unless it comes before council and we as a group decide on what the change is going to be. I hear Lorette's concern and I agree with it. You know, we don't want to just open it up to anything flies or whatever, but we want to make sure that we're asking for people to think outside the box, but yet this council and future councils will ultimately make the decision on does that fit? Is that what they want? You know, we on council 5-6 years ago, you know, not only we approved Martin Plastics, people don't even talk about the property right to the south of that that'll start being built as soon as that project's done. So, you know, there's a lot of things happening that councils at the time had to look at and said for that time that seemed to be the best decision. What I'm hoping is that whatever goes forward, and I agree with you, Rita, we want to make sure that anything that goes forward, we, you know, councils will make sure, and hopefully PNZs, whoever we appoint on there, we'll make sure that it fits our model. Thinking of improvements, I personally love to get rid of our green, boring street signs. I'd love to see something different. I have some ideas that everyone wants to ask. You know, just that green and white. Just I know we're a green and white city, but the signs are boring. And it doesn't say that we're out of Denver and in Inglewood. You know, you go to Centennial, there's signs of change. You go to somewhere else, they have, you know, just simple things that can make us look unique and different. And that's like, capitalize the unique characteristics associate opportunities of enhancing the value of Inglewood's commercial and mixed-use districts. Am I on the right one? I think I am. You know, those are something, you know, how do we want to look different? And so I hope that, you know, we ask people to be creative. We ask people to start looking at things to think out, to make them different. I don't want to be like Denver. I don't want to be like Littleton. I don't want to be like, you know, Greenwood Village or Cherry Hills Village. I want to be like Inglewood and what makes Inglewood different. Right now, there's not much difference. And I love when we interviewed you, Mr. Keck, I love what you said about our city when your initial...
No need to repeat.
You gave a very blunt opinion that was very factual, and I know it offended maybe a person or two, but, you know, sometimes we have to realize that we're a city that needs some updating. But that updating needs to meet the character and the zoning and the desire of not only our community, but this council needs to make sure that it approves it. So therefore, I have no problems with what's being presented, because ultimately, we're going to have control over it anyway.
Thank you. I am going to skip over myself and go to Linda so I can summarize that.
I'm fine with these for the same reasons. So.
Thank you. You know, I think I heard pretty broad support for those. I did hear a couple of members talk about the through zoning reform language of 4.5. If there's some suggestion there for staff, I suppose we're open to some of the, you know, changes to the language. What about through zoning reforms, if and when appropriate? Does that seem much better? Does that seem better to most?
I'm fine with that.
I
know we're not voting, but...
Is it appropriate to put approved by council?
Yes.
It will be.
It does kind of go without saying, but if that would help some members
then.
Get us to a consensus, I'm open to it. Or the community.
I think we have consensus.
I know, but we are doing this with the attitude that we're going to be the same council. And as you heard, for the last, ever since the 2003 and you, plan went in, and you heard somebody mention that every single time, I think it was you, Rick, that said every time we did something, Jim Woodward got up and said, per the 2003 roadmap to Inglewood plan, that's exactly what future councils are going to do. What we do matters, and the attitude that we're putting something, committing it to a master plan, but giving the caveat that, well, we're going to be able to change things and do what we want when it comes, is not the intent of the plan. It's the intent of the plan that if the plan's being followed, that the future councils are going to use this as a guideline to do that. And so I don't think that that's going to save us from anything. because also what you said was that they went ahead and put these projects in because they thought they were good things at the time. And that's not what you have a master plan for either. You're supposed to have a guideline so that people aren't just putting things in. We don't want to dictate the market, but we don't want the market dictating to us, because the market changes and is pretty fluid, and we want to try and keep some restraint on that while we're working with them, but not just whatever's the flavor of the day. That's what the comp plan is supposed to be taking care of. And we're expecting, just like the 2003 roadmap, that gets taken into account, not constantly somebody going, oh, by the way, they said, you know, we're supposed to just do what we want at the time that the project comes to us. It's not going to be what saves us is doing an appropriate comp plan with the intent that the comp plan is going to be followed.
Do you have any alternative to the three zoning reform language?
Oh, no, my interest, I mean, like I said, the whole, come on, seriously? No, I'm pro parks. I had a problem with the zoning thing because it's so vague and so, I mean, it's ridiculous. We're going to go ahead and encourage, well, we can't ensure a wide range of desirable amenities, but we can certainly try to encourage, we do recreational, retail, quality of housing in all neighborhoods. But through the zoning reform, it just doesn't mean anything. It doesn't mean anything. I don't know what it's supposed to.
Fair enough.
I said it was for retail.
You know, the reason we have the build on Oxford and Navajo and the one coming behind it and the others, because that's what the 2003 comp plan called for. It called for high density. It called for building more of that. And the reason that I was one of the proponents of getting rid of the old plan is that I didn't want that everywhere in the city and getting rid of all our industrial. And I wanted to make sure that we had a plan that could be adjustable as future council saw need, and that we didn't have someone, we weren't bound to this 2003 document in 2012. So the hope, you know, and I hear what Lorette's saying, but the hope is that what we had to deal with then doesn't happen anymore. We could say, you know, that was a plan then, but just like home offices. You know, home offices weren't allowed in the 2003 plan. They are now because, you know, this council finally made a change on how that is. We want to make sure that we give not only our council, but future councils the right to change things as times and events change, and not be bound, but yet still have a general goal of where we'd like to go. And that's how I see this, and that's how I'd like to move forward with it.
Thank you, Rita.
Actually, I was thinking, I don't have a problem with this. Why don't we just move the last phrase, through zoning reforms where appropriate? Because the truth is, even right now, councils have been using zoning reforms. That doesn't have to be in there at all. Just remove that last phrase.
Just remove through zoning reforms where appropriate?
Yes.
Thoughts on that suggestion? I'm okay with that.
I'm okay.
Yeah, I think we're okay with that. You guys got that.
Can I ask a question about that? Do you see that as limiting us or making it difficult for you in the long run if we remove that? Either of you?
Simple head shake. No.
Given that we can,
I just want to make sure from community development, if that's the case, can you? Then it doesn't really give them anything if we leave it in either.
Agreed, and that's why I'm open to your suggestion on language here.
If it doesn't make any difference if we leave it in, and it doesn't make any difference to them if we for their power if we leave it out, then it goes back to my original point.
I think some people in council are nervous about any zoning reforms, and I don't think we should be. I think that's the right of council to rezone when needed.
That was the comment I was about to just make. If you don't like, it's basically that, you know, this is a planning document, not a regulatory document. I feel like some of us feel like we're painting ourselves into a corner. You know, keep in mind that I think what was the problem with the roadmap 2003 is that we didn't revisit it for 13 years.
Ever.
You know what I mean? And this plan. Changing this comp plan, it's going to be in front of the council on an annual basis, and so, and a more deeper dive, I think it's every 5 years.
after attending classes on comp plans, their comments really is that comp plans really only have about a 10-year lifespan. And you have to constantly review where you're at in that, or it's just useless. You might as well not even do it. 20 years, who knows what 20 years is going to bring? I mean, everything may be flying cars as far as we know. Yeah, I know that's kind of out there, but maybe it's not. We have no idea. We have no idea. So, you know, if we want to make a comment that this is what we're thinking 20 years, but it's going to be totally different. So we need to plan more for when we're doing hard planning for five to 10 years. And then we also have to have, and this is where the goals of council comes in, is we need to have that 30,000-foot view, like our founding fathers of Inglewood, and or I shouldn't say founding fathers of Inglewood, but some of the previous councils, by purchasing the water rights. They had that view that, hey, we have to have these water rights, or we may not be around. Or for us, it could be looking at, you know, building out our park systems like we're doing. We're making a signature for our community, and it's going to affect our children's generation and our grandchildren's as to how well we do that. And frankly, if we do it well, 50 years from now, they can say, thank goodness council had the foresight to try to create a community where people walk down the street, talk to each other, have a place to do things, parks are interconnected, you know. I'm starting to babble now, but there we go.
Yeah, one day hopefully they'll look on us as favorably as we look on some of the previous councils, like you said. My suggestion now, we'll move on to goal work three. Oh, I'm sorry.
There's a good thing of leaving zoning in there, and that is to remind folks that read this that zoning reform could come and go, and that that's a way to handle changes so that it doesn't just happen. There is a process with some reformation in it. That would be my vote to keep it in. Would be just as a sort of a reminder of that.
And again, I guess my preference was if and when appropriate, because the where appropriate almost makes it sound like there are appropriate places, and that's why the if and when kind of like, you know, says if you find a plot, then, you know, I don't know.
If and when appropriate sounds fine to me too. I just think it's helpful sometimes to have reminders in there of what it is. And then the other piece I would say to echo what Steve said very quickly is that if you've ever worked for a larger institution, no one sees a comp plan or strategic plan past 10 years. It's just not what's been done for a very long time. To think that it's 20 years is really kind of silly. In this day and age with the fast-changing pace of technology and everything in it, unfortunately, then allows for the future council to get mad at the past to say, well, it didn't go for 20 years. You did a bad job of creating one, which I have heard here. So I just think it's really 10 years is about all you can expect. But if you do continual upgrades, you might not need to do a whole thing in 10 years. You might just be able to make shifts here and there. I don't know. But we'll see in 10 years. I'm going to be on a jetpack then.
I'm sorry. So I thought I had consensus to remove through zoning and reforms. I guess I just want to double check that again now.
I say leave it.
Okay. Amy, where are you at on that?
Very legally technical for a document that isn't legally binding.
This is the situation of too many chefs ruining the stew. I'm sure of it, but you know,
we
I
made
like
it
this
quite clear.
I'm fine with it all.
Everybody made it clear. It doesn't matter if it's in. It doesn't make any more difference if it's in or out. So whichever one you want to pick for me, Joe.
Okay.
I'm
leaving you on the fence for now, Steve.
At a certain point in time, I think maybe we're getting too far into the weeds. It's a spirit of where we're going with this. So I don't care either way.
Okay. Rita, where are you at on this? You're removing, right?
I am for removing only because it doesn't matter. We're going to use zoning reforms to change it anyway, but why do we have to put all that wording in there?
will heed that warning and move on to Steve is what I'll do.
I'm going to be very careful how I state this because it can be a landmine. First, I think the open market should be the real decider in this. And if we use urban renewal like some other communities, not in favor of it at all. Now, here in Inglewood, we're doing kind of a thing where we're not allowing urban renewal to have a whole lot of tooth behind what they do. We're not telling them, go out there, be an activist, blight that land, change it, you know. I'm not in favor of that. But if we have a project like the Medici Project, where they can be helpful in guiding that, taking some of the stress off of staff, being potentially some liaison between the developer and the city, then that type of situation I think is appropriate. It needs to be used sparingly.
Rita.
Italicized, then it's an objective or a goal that was disapproved by council members.
I'm going off a non-italicized version. Nothing is italicized. And that's what I'm going off of. Anyway, I would make your comments as if it was just the objective, if you only have issues with the objective.
Okay,
just Reduce commuting. You know what I mean? I think it's saying make a better match of your jobs market and your housing market so that more people live and work in the same area.
Right.
And I think it's a sustainability issue, really, more than, you know, an environmental kind of an issue.
Could it? I mean, when I read the Denver article about Englewood as a bedroom community and the stuff we got for our news stuff, it just irked me.
Yeah. I didn't know we were a bedroom community.
And I've never heard anybody call it that before. But I guess, you know, but I think this would help say that's not what we want to be. We want to be a community with jobs and housing and retail opportunities, and we want it to be a walkable city where you don't have to go work somewhere else. You can be here and actually, so.
So I think it's saying if you mix your development types that more of that matching can happen rather than having a housing area that's on the west side of town and all the jobs are on the east side of town.
That's not, I hear your attempt, that's not what it says. It said
this as a sustainability issue, and just, you know, we generally have a role not to dictate the market, but to provide opportunities for, you know, reduction of commuting and those type of things. So, and I think that that makes a more substantial place for placemaking, in that, you know, younger folks particularly, and I think, you know, my age group and younger want to kind of live and work and play kind of in the same area. And where they see those opportunities, I think, makes it a more desirable place to be. If you don't mind, I'm going to finish the round robin, then I'll get to Steve. Linda?
I like this, and I'm one of those who enjoys where I live because I can actually walk to work. It's a bit of a walk, but I can walk to the store, I can walk to the bank, I can walk, I mean, I think a lot of age groups
Fair enough,
are moving towards this, so, and but I would love to see us not be seen as a bedroom community either, so I would like to continue to work on the jobs thing and employment.
Weird, I think our population increases substantially during the day, so to call us a bedroom community, I think
it's
just
weird.
Straight up inaccurate, but that's just me.
Yeah, I actually really like things also, and I lived in several communities where I loved that I could walk to work and could walk to the grocery store and walk to do club things, and right now I can walk to the grocery store and can walk to do a couple things, but I can't walk to work. I wish I worked in Englewood, but I have to drive 30 minutes to get to work.
Could get on the rail.
Right, and the light rail doesn't really go there easily. I could take that, but and as far as objective work three, encourage mixed use development. Rita, to your point, to me, when I read mixed use development, I don't automatically think high density. I think of mixed use as kind of just maybe a couple places to live and a couple, you know, retail opportunities. I worked at a place that was this type of development in when I lived in another city, and they had probably, I don't know, the first floor was businesses, and maybe it had like two floors of lofts, and it was perfect. It wasn't like high density. But I guess that's a clarification that we need to be comfortable with. And I don't see mixed use as high density at all. But that's just my opinion.
And I, you know, my house is single family mixed use.
Thanks for that information.
Not all mixed use is high density.
And how much density do you have in that house?
Although the projects we've been doing are high density. The mixed use projects that are going in that people are concerned about are definitely high density. The ones that are coming in to the community right now are pretty high density. So that, I think that's what they're talking about. So which one of the three? I could rip the pages out of here from the confusion of what's going on here. But for the I'm for jobs. I don't know how you're going to, again, really, I'm not, if it goes to the high density, it's inappropriate. We're not supposed to be marketing everything to the people that we want to have come. We're supposed to be listening to the people that are here that have already invested in this community. Whether somebody else calls us a bedroom community or a skyscraper community or whatever, we're the ones who have to define ourselves. I'm not worried about what anybody else is calling us or changing us based off of what some other comment got made. But we have to take into consideration the people who have invested in this community and are here today, and they don't want the density, although they are for jobs, even if they have to leave the city to go to them. And as far as the other three that you guys started on, which was the you don't capitalize on urban renewal. You either have blight and you use urban renewal for it. You do not use it for obsolescent land, whatever that vagueness is. It is specifically defined in the law what you use urban renewal for, and it's for blight, not for obsolescence or something you think could make you more money, or you don't think that business operates well enough, you think you could put something better there. That's not what it's there for. Urban renewal is not, by law, not to be used for that. It's not what it's there for. Medici is not an urban renewal project. It is not a project, and it is not an urban renewal project. It is land. It is being done on land that the Urban Renewal Authority owned. They could have simply sold it, and it would have gone through every other process just like it has. It's not TIF, there isn't anything, it's just land that they owned that they've sold, and they seem to be liking managing the process, but it's not an urban renewal project. I've gone through the, I still don't know whether there's some things on the property that in the acquiring of that might be still some covenants, since I just had a meeting with the assessor's office to find out that there was a plan from urban renewal as well as the downtown authority as well. So I haven't had a chance to get through that from my meeting. I wish I could have gotten it from my numerous requests from our own departments, but the assessor had a copy of it, so I got it from them. But there's a difference between an urban renewal project and land that the urban renewal authority happens to own, and that Medici's coming in. They don't seem to have any requirements. We're not giving them money. There's not any. They're two different things. And the market, I mean, we don't decide that. We have to take, as far as I'm concerned, the urban renewal piece of that out of there. Urban renewal is not an economic development tool, nor is it something that we just use for what we consider to be obsolescent uses of land on it. It's not appropriate. It's not what it's for. So I would want that taken out.
Thank you,
and
ma'am.
I'm still for jobs.
And I think we did have general consensus. Did you want to go again, Steve?
Yeah, now that I'm on the right subject here.
Please go ahead, yeah. Yeah, I'm like, boy, a lot of URA comments.
Yeah.
Which is fine, though. Again, I'm happy to get a little bit off topic because I feel like we need to kind of get rolling on a few of these issues. So.
Okay. On goal work 3, in here they're not talking about doing high density. What I read out of this is they would like to have a community that is a, for the lack of a better term, a full use community, where if you live close to Pearl Street, you can walk to the restaurant and enjoy something. I'm talking about Pearl in Denver. But we'd have something similar to here. When you go to work, you could literally bike or walk to work. We have opportunities for work. We have the opportunities for living. You know, just it's kind of a full use. So with all of these things right here, on objective 3, I really don't see anything wrong with it. I kind of see it as a return back to the 50s in certain ways. Of more community.
The neighborhood store kind of vibe,
yeah.
Right? Rita?
Just for everyone's information, because I have lived here a long time, Inglewood has always been known as a bedroom community. People slept here but worked in other places. That is not a new term that just came up. That's what traditionally Inglewood has always been. I think the problem that we're going to have is where are all of these people going to work that we want to bring in here? Because already, I mean, the population is over 30,000. We do not have 30,000 places of employment. But fortunately right now, a lot of the people that live here are retired. But I'm just wondering, are we going to be able to employ all of those people? So.
Rick?
And as far as the mixed use goes, I liked what Amy said. She doesn't view it as high density. And maybe if we're going to look at that, maybe we should limit the height of buildings, as high as they can go up and the number of units, especially if they're above the industrial area businesses.
Thank you. Rick?
Just two quick comments. One is I would beg for us to remove the word to and add the word and, encourage a regional balance of jobs and housing. I think that would make me feel more comfortable that we're not trying to do a one for one. And secondly, half the people on my block work at home. They do. I work at home. My wife, we have two offices in my house. My office downstairs, my wife's upstairs, my neighbors. Everybody works at home. So it's funny if you come to my neighborhood in the middle of the day, neighbors are out. You would think none of us work, but we're at work. And that's kind of the trend of what's happening. My wife's official workplace is in Colorado Springs, but she works remote out of the house. and a lot of people are doing that. So when we talk about communities and work, a lot of people's houses will be their work. So I'm hoping that that continues, and I kind of see that as a trend. I agree with Rita. I'm concerned that we're not having room for more business to come in. I've been talking about it for Joe and Linda know since day one of council. I want to protect some industrial area. I would have loved the ironworks to be all industrial, and I'm with a group right now who would love to find a 25 to 50,000 square foot facility in Inglewood. I cannot find it. We're going to have to buy land and build it. There is no industrial space at all. We'll take anything, and it's just not available. So, and we have a lot of money to spend to give. So it's not a matter of money. It's a matter of, you know, we have taken so much of our industrial and converted it, and I hope we stop this. I'm in agreement with that. But I want to make sure that, you know, we help people live and work maybe in the same facility. And I'm thanking Mr. Keck for, I saw something on Nextdoor that just, I thought it was a very disparaging comment of, you know, of the type of people who are coming into Inglewood, like as if people who spend $2,500 on an apartment are they're bad people. That's almost double my mortgage, so, you know, I kind of wish I had the job they had. Maybe I'd do better. But we want to make Inglewood make sure that we're a community that balances their job and their housing. So that's why I'm asking for the word "to" to be removed and the word "and" to be inserted. And I think that makes more sense to me personally. I'm extremely anal and OC that if I see this to this, it has to be this to this. And maybe there'll be another council member down the line who'll be just as anal as I am about that issue. So
I like that one. I like it too.
One more of the two.
Oh, look at that. Ah. Oh, my God.
Anybody else want to comment? Is there anybody else in the queue there? No, I don't believe so.
Point.
Okay,
so point. Inglewood has 30,000 people approximately as residents. At any point in time during the daylight hours, we have anywhere between 90 and 110,000 people in our community. So
bigger than our current
there
population.
Is a lot of opportunity there.
Agreed. And I, you know, that's what we talked about with the job fair. I'm really hopeful that our local chamber will take on that job fair and try to help match up some of these things.
And then if you add in all the people that are working in their homes, it's even more. So you don't, that doesn't even get counted in that piece. So we do have lots of jobs.
Guys, I think I'm going to call it there unless you guys are anxious to get into the next one.
Nope.
My thought is let's go ahead and call it there.
Let you know that I have a commitment tomorrow night that was unexpected, so I will not be at the executive committee meeting, but I am concerned about the process, so all I would ask is that somehow it become very clear as to, if you're going into that meeting and you're going to get to look at vitas for candidates that you're going to choose, I think it's really unfortunate that we didn't get those in a timely manner to have read them before that, so I hope you don't have to read them all while you're there and decide. But if you do, I trust what you decide, but I just don't like this process, and so I'd like to register that with you if you can find out. I know Eric has been confused about who's in charge of what, but if we can get it really clear as to who's the point person on this process, because we don't have the traditional HR director we had before, it seems like we need some clarity in the timeline, and I thought this company was pretty clear in their timeline, which is why we all voted for them. So if you can clarify that tomorrow night, and I apologize for not being there.
I wish I could tell you the answer to that. I know that HR manager Jaylene Schell has been in contact with Doug Thomas from SGR. However, I am uncertain of the overall number of applicants that you'll be looking at tomorrow. I know that they've done some screening from talking with Jaylene. SGR has done some screening already and is going to be bringing some candidates to you to look at tomorrow. But yeah, I was surprised that you didn't get the materials.
For those of you that weren't involved at the city manager perspective, we got them all confidentially delivered to our homes, looked at them, and then came to a meeting and went through and picked who we all agreed or whatever our candidates were to bring in for interviewing. And I understand how it needs to be confidential at this stage because
that bigger, kind of to get another perspective of what's going on. But there's another group, and Rita might have more information on this. If you're going to bring that up, then go ahead. It's this Thursday, and I think that it gives. We're not the first ones going through this, and the successes and failures of Wednesday, not Thursday, but Rita can give you that, of information. We're not the first to do this, and the successes and failures that the other communities have had with this are not surprises. If I love to go down to Pearl Street, but I've got some friends that live down there. You know, they're not so thrilled with it. So having a Gaylord or Pearl Street and living in that community with the parking and the things that are going on are two different things, and they've got to be matched up. It just can't be from the city side of it with the money. So those have to be taken into account. But I think some of this information is good, and they bring up, at least if we're going to move forward, some of the realistic situations that we'll be faced with in dealing with those. During the one of the things that I brought up earlier was the part of the incentive thing. I think that both Rita and I had asked for this information. I happen to still have the one from April 27th, which isn't a comprehensive list of all the incentives and stuff, but just the taxes that we did not collect was over $1.5 million. Just the taxes we didn't collect that we were entitled to collect, let alone that the developers aren't putting something in. We need to address impact fees and making sure that we're collecting the taxes that we're currently entitled to collect on these projects so that they're paying and not put that burden on the community. So we need to keep that in mind, and I would like to see us move forward with the impact fees and kind of get stuff going before everything is built, and then we don't collect them until the next round of stuff going on. Also, it got brought up about EIF and EMERF wanting to go ahead and dissolve their boards, but I hope that that process happens through council. I had asked for the minutes from those meetings and that those be recorded. I was told by Mr. Murphy that they would be. I'd like to have access to them, please, so that when this is being bantied about that they discussed, that I would like to hear that discussion so that we have some transparency here. That would be awesome. And then the discussion that's going on with Sports Authority, I think that it would, like the mayor had brought up, needs to come to council as well with the city center and the thing, and I know you guys are planning on doing that, but I didn't know Galloway and the comment that the city manager made is that Galloway says we can load this area up with people. It's like, what's going on? So hope you keep that. But you rightfully so, you said that it was part of the comp plan discussion, and I just want to make sure that whatever this gentleman is or his role that he's playing comes forward in this, that's coming forward in that, that if we have somebody else that's making comments or researching, even if it's a small area plan, which is starts to be, that is a PUD, which Rita would be interested in hearing about if somebody else is planning a PUD already on Sports Authority, and I'm sure that's where you got that from because you attend that meeting. I had an opportunity with some additional questions that happened on the urban renewal, both with Medici, the downtown plan, what's going on. The minute that we broke ground, we created increment. That increment won't be collected because that assessment is done on January 1st of each year, but that will be as of the 1st of 17. And so we have to make a decision because the information that Mr. Stitt provided on the whether we get the TIF or not, he made the comment that if there's TIF and no project, that it just flows back to the entities it was collected from. That is not true. That is not accurate. It does not just flow back. That means that the authority would have to be closed, and that's the only way that that would be done. So I know that and greatly appreciate that our city manager is going to be meeting with the assessor and with the people that have some expertise in this area. That that's a very difficult thing to have happen unless you, it's impossible to have happen unless you close the authority by law. So we are going to have to deal with that, and I would rather deal with it sooner than later. They are bound not to spend that money. That is not just free money, nor does it go to the city. It has to, it goes to the Urban Renewal Authority. And without debt to pay, they have no legal way to disperse that money. So I know that Eric is going to find out some more about it, and he'll get a copy of the plans and stuff. And so both with any potential problems that are with Medici from that downtown plan and the Urban Renewal Authority plan that was on that area as well. And there are some comments in there that some covenants might be made on that land as of the time of the deed for 30 years from the time of the deed being signed, which might have gone past some of that. So there, we're kind of researching that a little bit more to see if there's any of that. And aside from, if you could please make sure that you can hear the attorney, who I know is in the room, then so that when you're asking him questions,
we'll get them all mic'd up.
Yeah, I would greatly appreciate that. Although he was quick to, I didn't talk. I didn't say anything. I was like, oh, okay, right.
His defense, he doesn't mind a lot, okay. But yes, we will get them mic'd up next time, don't you
mind? No, you only spoke when they talked to you. I get that. But I didn't hear the answers you gave them. So if we could get that taken care of.
Thank you for those meaty comments. I would suggest that we put impact fees onto the future study session topics. If most of council can agree with that, I'm seeing a lot of nodding. And so I'm going to suggest that we take a look at impact fees. City Center.
They already were on that list, were they not?
They were not.
Oh, I thought they were part of that. Definitely be on there.
I thought they got talked about, but I didn't say, yeah.
Talk
just,
about it,
yeah.
We never added it to
that's
the list.
Fine.
I'm just going to let you know. I'm going to add it to the list now. But
I was under the understanding that the city manager's office was putting something together to bring to us. So that's probably the first step, is let him get his information together and then bring it forward.
Okay. it's June, so
then,
we can get that.
City
I had one more thing
okay.
Real quick. On the paths that are being done, that we're working with, on the river front thing with Sheridan and Sheridan goes through South Suburban, and I ran into a South Suburban board member. I thought it might be a good idea if we included them in the Tri-Cities meeting with some of the things that are going on with the construction, that I've had some complaints about some of the way the construction and the paths are being handled, and some people had some accidents from some materials that were being used. It would just be nice to get an update in how they're participating in that as well.
Sorry, who would go to Tri-County?
The South Suburban, a board member, somebody from South Suburban. Yeah.
Okay.
Since they handle both Littleton and Sheridan, and we're doing a project in conjunction with Sheridan, and they're part of that, I mean, that's their property.
Fair enough. And then the city center, again, we're going to have under future study session. I've got that already. The TIF issue, I guess I'm wondering what's the best way to deal with that. I mean, do you think we can do it as a council request and get some clarity on where we're at on this TIF issue? And that's why I'm
well, he's meeting with him on Thursday to do that.
But I would suggest a council request would be appropriate unless you want to bring it back for a study session. I guess I just want to put something on there if you want to come back to council.
Can we get information? And then
let's do it. If you don't mind, I'm going to suggest a council request on
right.
The TIF issue to make sure we're all on the same page on the TIF issue, and then disseminate that information to council so we're all on the same page. And then if we feel like we need to discuss
right.
it at a study session, we'll go ahead and schedule it.
Right. All I'm asking is that prior to that money coming through, which there will be none from this year, it will be assessed from the groundbreaking, will be assessed whatever that value is, and that value will be more than the deficit we are at right now. We are at about a $500,000 deficit. If the construction, which I already assume in a $48 million project, is going to merely by the groundbreaking, is going to exceed the deficit that we're at the $500,000, then we will have increment. And so that won't be assessed until next year, so we do have time, but we do have to address how we're going to handle
thank
it.
You.
Okay, I'll keep it fairly light. MOA. I have to say, since we had the discussion, I don't know, a year or so ago, maybe it was less, I don't know, time blurs after a while. And I was basically saying maybe we shouldn't give them that money anymore, the donation. and maybe give it to cultural arts or do something else. I have to say MOA has really came up and started becoming very active within our community, which is exactly what we want. You know, if they're going to be here, then be a participant. They've got talking to them over there. It's Tim, right?
Yes.
He's got some great ideas of how to activate and have some events around here, around the Civic Center and stuff like that. So I have to say they're doing a good job. He did speak to us a little about utility boxes and painting them. Excel is not so, I guess they're not cooperative at all. Well, I'm just going to throw this out here. Some of their boxes look like you know what. And yeah, and they don't do anything with them. So I think as a city, we would have the right to start writing them tickets for tagging. For having tagged box, I should say. And then at that point in time, then we can have a discussion. Maybe it's like, hey, we have a way that these things can get cleaned up. And we'll follow any necessary markings that you need in order to locate them and so on. Help out our cultural arts committee and MOA in being able to do more projects. The project of painting some of these boxes, I think, is a great job. They're looking really awesome. I think it could be an event that really brings multiple sectors of our community together. We have many historical areas within our community, and many of these boxes are close to them. So the Historical Society or someone could be in charge of telling the story of what happened here. And that's a tapestry they could work with. We can get the seniors involved. We can get the middle-aged millennials, whatever you want to call them, involved too. So it's something that everyone can be a part of. Also, this art would change over the years, so it's continually bringing the community back in and bringing some pride into our community. Then I went over to the River Walk. It was later one evening, and I lost my phone over there. Oh, I was, and I didn't realize I was missing it until I was going to bed to go plug it in. It's like, where is it? Fortunately, it was exactly where I lost it. You know, but I had a good idea where.
Exactly where that was.
I had a good idea.
I never really lost it.
I jumped off of one wall and down about 4 feet, and it fell out of my pocket. What can I say? But that project over there is pretty awesome, and the surfing they're going to do, I tell you what, people are going to come from all around to do that, and that's a part of the vision of our community that in the future people will say, you know, councils before had a good idea. We've got recognition. It's gonna bring back many fold. So there you go.
Thank you, sir. Rita.
Actually, I have a few things. Since Lorette brought this up, I do have a couple of these flyers. It's called The Vanishing American Dream, and Randall O'Toole is a Cato Institute senior fellow working on urban growth, public land, and transportation issues. His latest book is American Nightmare, How Government Undermines the Dream of Home Ownership. He is actually speaking
say we Skype them all.
It's the wave of the future. So, yeah, let's take advantage of it. There may be other opportunities to use that technology.
We've done it before by phone.
Yeah, great. Okay. So we'll try to get that set up for, and you'll provide his information or whatever after the meeting if you don't mind.
I will.
Thank you. A few things. Number one, I am very upset with Excel. Excel came into Bellevue Park and cut down numerous trees, beautiful trees, in areas that I don't feel that they needed to be cut down. The second problem is Excel left big old stumps up on the ground, and the city ended up putting the bill to get those stumps ground. I am not happy with them. They are bullies. They decimated a beautiful area of the park, and just I'm dumbfounded. I would love Tom Henley to be here soon. I'm just the boxes and with what they've done. They just randomly go in, and then they also don't pick up. They cut the tree. They leave the piles there, and then so people in the community eventually come and get them and take them away. And it just that's got to be addressed.
So when they did the alleys, they did nothing. People complain they sat in a truck and cut nothing, and they go into our park and cut everything down.
Beautiful,
just like they did in our
trees.
Golf course a couple years ago. They took out a whole row of trees.
Yeah, and the problem was, listen, I didn't like that enough. But then Mr. Keck saw they left these big old stumps right in the middle of like a play area where a tree used to be. So it was so we ended up putting the bell for them cutting down trees that didn't need to be cut down. So I'd love them to explain the reason.
I would suggest as a council request for Eric to make a call to Tom tomorrow.
Oh, I also think we ought to write a letter.
You already have. Okay.
I think we need to send them
a
bill for
letter.
Trees.
Yeah, I think
yes.
Complaint to them too, as well as ask them to come. I don't think they're going to
take it. They're one of these. They're one of the incentive things. Give us back our $300,000 there or something.
I've actually talked to Mr. Henley on several occasions. Last year when they did the same thing in Centennial Park, where they topped trees and then they didn't fix that, and they basically said, well, we gave you notice that what was going to happen. We have the right, you have trees in our easement. This year, again, he was contacted, and he basically said, I'm telling you, our policy is we don't pay for the grinding of stumps. That's your responsibility because we told you not to plant trees in our easement.
How old are these trees?
Old.
Mature,
yeah, these trees were.
Do you think they were prior to Excel then? The lines?
Yeah.
Probably. Yeah, probably.
Could be.
Yeah.
Oh, that is infuriating.
Yeah. So,
which
so
came
I would,
first?
I just think Tom needs to come and hear some of our,
We'll put him on the agenda for a future topic, but yeah, that is the most frustrating aspect because we actually were able to talk them out of clear-cutting several trees out of Centennial Park, which, by the way, has no shade to begin with. So it is troubling.
So that's number one. Number two, we had a wonderful school board city meeting. Please, if you can, come to the mixer next Wednesday.
Are you still having it?
The day of my freaking community meeting.
No.
It's this next Wednesday.
I heard at the mayor meeting that they might cancel that, so is it or not?
I can't make it. I don't know.
Whatever the date is, June 29th. Right, June 29th.
Right.
That's right.
That's what I have.
Is it still on or not?
Wednesday of the month. I don't know. Has everybody responded?
I heard
I was the only one who couldn't attend.
For this?
Community meeting is the last Wednesday of every month for the last 9 years.
Come over after community meeting.
I will.
At Calori.
From the meeting, it left it as if you guys hadn't decided whether it was still happening. Is it still happening?
Yeah, we talked about at the last meeting, maybe we're just going to all go to dinner and get to know each other as a group and decide, kind of continue our partnership, but it would be nice to have both groups together.
No, I got that part, but at the mayor-manager meeting, when I listened to it, it made it sound as if we were still not agreed on the date.
I was hoping that we would go to a different day, but I sound like I'm the only one.
That's the only date that works.
And that's fine. I mean, you guys continue.
Okay.
I'll show up a little later.
Then it's still the same date. That's all I was looking for.
Yeah, just
for
June 29th.
Okay.
Yeah.
But anyway, we talk about joint marketing, and we had some, Mr. Keck was there about marketing that would work for our communities, especially for our new projects. So that was exciting. We had Judge Atencio at our code enforcement meeting last. It was worth the price of admission. And was a member or two who were thinking of doing, what was it? What you said not to do?
Decriminalization.
Yeah, decriminalization. Sorry. It's late. It's after 9. Decriminalization, and the judge explained very thoroughly how decriminalization would basically tie his hands and how it would actually harm us more than help us. So I thought that was a great talk. He answered every question, and we talked about the whole process. I don't know if that's on tape or not. I think it is. If he did a great presentation. You probably should listen to the tape if you have some time. And it was a 3-hour meeting. I got there an hour late. They started at 6:30. It actually started at 5:30. But anyway, and I was glad I got there at 6:30 because it didn't end until 8:30. But anyway, so great things happening with code. They're going to be bringing forward, Murphy, tell me if I'm right or wrong, the hour of operation. They've made a decision, and then we're presenting that to council for hour of operations of our businesses and community. So a lot of great things going on in there. And last thing, I want to thank you for allowing me to miss last Monday. I never just not come. I had a situation that I need to give attention to, and appreciate your understanding. And it sounds like you all did a great job without me. So, I mean, I did watch it afterwards on. It's really interesting. The picture's too small. When you blow it up, you can't see your faces. I'm hoping that maybe we. That's some of it's a little, but it the what I really I'm 99%. There were two comments. One is, if you blow it up full screen, it's everything, you know, it's blurry. Just for council, whoever's talking at the podium, you can see them perfectly. You can see members in the audience really well. And the second thing is you don't get to see the vote. When you vote, there's no pan on, you know, the vote board that shows who voted what. That is the only thing that when I was sitting, I'm like, well, where's the vote board? And I guess it's because I'm used to seeing, because I always look at the vote board every vote. So that's the only comment I had. But I'm excited for this. How many of you, I know I heard, but I watched this tonight, and I'm the only one that the video adds pounds to, so.
the video adds pounds to, yeah.
So, but everybody else looked great.
Happens.
Well, they just plant the tree.
always been helpful when Randy would bring those in. So I don't know if, I mean, I just think it'd be nice to be kept in the loop. That body does not move very quickly on anything. So I think then if you know you need some advice from us on something you're finding controversial, then ask us.
So what I'll do is
can I also just say one? I forgot one other thing. Tomorrow is at Cutting Loose is the chamber after hours. So anyway, I forgot to say that. It is tomorrow, right before our executive session, and they knew that, and they said, please come anyway, so go have your glass of wine, and then go to
bed.
It's at 5.
Okay, so you got time to stop.
Yes, and it's just right down here, so there's no excuse not to go, right?
All right, I'll stop.
I inserted it. So
no, thank you.
Go on with Dr.
Thank you for that. No, and I'll bring that forward for next week, knowing that we'll want to have some feedback, it sounds like. Are others okay with that generally? Okay.
Thank you, Mayor, members of Council. A few weeks ago, when you had your initial study session on the topic of recreational marijuana, I think that staff heard from several members of Council that you wanted to obtain some more feedback from the public as it pertains to where they feel on this particular matter. One of the concepts that Deputy City Clerk Stephanie Carlisle and I came up with to assist you, and again, it's something I wanted to get clearance from the Council tonight, was to hold some community forums. I know that Councillor Barentine and Councillor Russell had a forum and they obtained some information, but we wanted to go outside the walls of City Hall here and not provide any pro or con, just listen to folks and understand the position of as many people who would want to come. We were thinking about, Stephanie and I were thinking about going onto the road and doing a listening tour, if you will, on the 31st, which is a Tuesday night, in Kent Village. Yeah, I think she's already nailed that down. But, again, before we did that, we want to get clearance of Council. And then also during the daytime on the 1st of June at the Malley Center, and then another one on Thursday night at the Inglewood Recreation Center. However, again, Council, if you don't want us to do that because you might feel, as it's been enunciated by a couple Council people, that this may be further stirring up the hornet's nest, we won't do it. But again, the object was so that you would have the opportunity to have more citizens come forth and give you comment prior to June 6 again, when you're going to be taking up the topic once more, as to provide us some direction as to what to do as staff. So this is merely a concept that, you know, I'd like to get some feedback tonight before we go ahead and do it. We've already nailed down the venues. But again, if you say don't go forth and do this, we will not.
Are we going to go around?
Yes.
I always think it's good to get input. I think the unfortunate part of it is that it won't be as broad as maybe we'd want. We've already gotten input on an advisory vote, but I'm fine with it. I would have wanted to do that in my district anyway, and the places you're going would be exactly where I would hold them. So, thank you. I'm fine with it.
Yeah, I'm fine with it as well. I think the more people we hear from, the better, and I think that's a good mix of locations and dates and times, so I think that would be helpful.
I think the more people that we hear from is helpful. I think when you go out with staff like that with a map and start showing circles and that looks, it's a different concept. Rita and I had a meeting, and we also had meetings outside of City Hall here too with people, and are planning to have another one. I think it's a dangerous thing when, with the suggestions that you had made during the manager meeting that I had listened to, were accurate. You said, I'm going to come back. I can't tell you what you can do legislatively, but I can tell you two things, yes or no, and distance. And it's the yes or no that you think you're going to go out and get from these things that I don't think is an appropriate venue, a position to put you in. I don't think it's an appropriate position to put you in. I think that's our job as the elected officials representing this community to make the decision on whether the temperature of this community is yes or no and how to go forward with it. I don't think that's an appropriate position to put you in.
Thank you, ma'am. Steve?
I think it's very appropriate. I have a feeling that people will speak a little bit more freely with staff on this issue than with specific council members, because a lot of folks have already got their, you know, prejudgment of exactly how each one of us feel about the issue. So if they feel that we're pro and they're pro, then they'll come and talk to us. If they feel that we're not, then they won't. So the more input we get, the better our decision process is going to be. And I'm not saying as council members that we shouldn't go out and talk. It's just we need a lot of information on this. Because if this ballot measure goes forward and they say, hey, we want retail marijuana every corner, and or whatever, they write it so vague that we can't regulate it, and the community hasn't, they don't understand the full implication, we could have a problem here. So the people need to be informed, and this is part of an education process for the community of the pros and cons, or the possibilities, I should say, not pros and cons. And it's good info, intel to us.
Thank you, sir. Rita?
Can I ask, how do you intend to advertise it or to get people out?
Again, this is a very tight time frame. That we're trying to push this to happen because we're trying to get some input for you before June 6th. We have the e-notifier system that we'll use, the city, for those who have signed up. We'll obviously have it on our website. Tom Munns has said, let me know if you're going to do this or not. He's asked me several times, and matter of fact, he called again today, and I wasn't able to tell him yes or no because I wasn't sure what the feedback would be from this group. So those are some of the means by which we would do it,
I'm open to have as much information as we can. We also know that, I don't know who you'll reach out to, but as far as citizen initiatives, only registered electors can sign the petition, and really only registered electors would decide what's going on apart from this board.
Sure.
So I guess I don't have a problem as long as you
That's my job, frankly. I appreciate the comments that Councillor Barentine meant, and it's not to usurp any of the council's authority or their ability to go out and do this. And so I hope you don't feel that's what I'm trying to do.
Oh, no, absolutely not. But that's how it's going to the perception from the people getting the information. Once you start drawing those circles, what they're going to look for is if their house is in a circle or not, and they're going to start taking that as that this is what council is agreeing to do or wants to do or is thinking of doing, and that's not the case.
I don't think we were going to propose to do any circles. I think what my thought was what or where would that be appropriate to have locations and see what people say. It might be just like, you know, don't text me, don't text the text man behind the tree kind of thing. That may be the case, but we don't know. So we just want to ask the question. It's not going to be any you're exactly right. I mean, I don't have any pro or con comments. It's just basically say, hey, we're here to listen. And if somebody were to say they're going to bring something forward and it does pass, where would you like to see these things transpire? That's all it is.
And then we're putting you in the position of assessing and disseminating the information then that you bring forward and being the spokesperson for that. I just think it's an inappropriate position to put you in.
Let's go back to Rita here.
Yeah.
Let's go back to Rita.
I think we all have our meeting.
I'm 100% behind you. I too, like I think most here, the more information the better. I would also recommend Nextdoor. We have immediate access to thousands of people.
No.
Holy cow.
Such a limited amount of people.
You want a wide variety of people if you're gutsy enough. just a notice. But I would ask that the question be asked, how far from your house would you like it? I think that's important. You know, if it's next to Joe's house, I don't care because he's way far away from me, but maybe Joe doesn't. Maybe he does. I don't know. But that would be an important question as well because that wasn't afforded to the people on federal and Bellevue. So I'm all for it. Thank you.
And just a fuck, you know, I think we do have consensus to move forward with them, but I'll share my thoughts for what it's worth. I'm not in favor of us going out and doing this. No matter what the data that you receive, it's not going to be any more compelling than the vote of the people that we had in 2013. And so, you know, I guess I'm concerned that it'll have an anti-marijuana slant. You know, I think generally when we have these type of public forums, you know, it will be generally anti-marijuana slant. I guess I'm concerned about what you'll present, you know, much like Lorette was saying. I don't think we've gained any consensus around, you know, 1,000 or 2,000 feet. I don't even think we have consensus on conversions. And so I guess I'm just wondering what you'll be telling them that it might be coming down the pike, because, you know, again, I don't see, you know, minus a citizen initiative, how we'd be looking at any of those other alternatives. And so, again, I just don't think it's helpful in those regards. But it sounds like we do have consensus to move forward with those.
Yeah, listen, I can find 1,000 things else to do with my time at night. And
sure.
But again, I'm merely putting this forward because I heard some concern from this council and this body as to trying to be open and trying to be transparent, trying to listen to people. And, you know, I don't want to be the city manager accused of not listening to folks, or you not being listening or not listening to folks, and when I could be a conduit with that without any agenda. I have no agenda. I live here too, very concerned with what's going to transpire.
Well, I know, but we had a meeting. Why wouldn't we just involve council then? Why wouldn't we just
Great.
Have more
you're,
town hall meetings?
You're more than welcome to show up to that, I guess. I think it's council's prerogative if you want to show for those events. Certainly, like I said, the only agenda that we had was to go out and listen and say, listen, residents, this is something that's an issue that's facing your community. How do you feel about it? And ask the question, what distancing would you feel comfortable with if something were to transpire? They're not going to know any more than what we know at this point in time about any initiatives that may or may not be happening. But we can tell them that there is a group that's asking for conversion. There's another group that may be asking for one on every corner. There's maybe a group that's out there saying no to all of it. So we just want to get the temperature that way. And understanding, again, that there was an advisory vote, all these other things, the council people have been out walking and talking. And I've had people knock on my door in my neighborhood in Rick's district, District 4, where I live, that have enunciated their opinion as well. So, you know, the more the merrier.
Really help with is to explain in a face-to-face way with people what the advisory vote was about, what the intent was, why, I mean, I'm just probably isn't fair for you, but why did council then vote no against it, which I truly think was because of the margins, and it was an advisory vote. It wasn't as overwhelming, compelling as we thought, but that we're at a different point now. I mean, I think that some of this can be just informing, but I think seeing maps and stuff is good for them. Maybe they want it to be walkable.
The council,
like the coffee shop.
Council apology tour.
I guess I just worry that. I guess
I don't want to put you in that place. I mean, if I were to go, I would only listen. That would be my role. I would not want to go. I mean, that's what I would do anyway. But I
think an explanation of the vote and council's action is probably inappropriate. But. That's an opinion.
Well, you'll be there. You can answer them.
And I guess I worry that this council isn't going to take this issue on, I guess, candidly, is what I'm worried about. So I guess I'm just worried that we're going to go ask the community a bunch of questions, and then we're not going to do anything, and it's going to be a valid issue anyway. And I think it's just a waste of our time. Steve?
Well, I have trust in our staff that they can present these questions in a neutral fashion. Purely based on you know, what if it were to happen, what would be an appropriate distance to be from your home or from XYZ, or as a community, if this were to happen, where should a business be located? Should it be in a residential neighborhood? Should it be a deep part of the industrial network, or should it be in a shopping mall? Or is this just off the table completely? I think I really trust staff in this situation to go out there and be neutral and just gather data.
I trust staff as well, but the data that they gather is not going to be scientific data, right? I mean, this is going to be data.
No,
the vote of the people in 2013.
We're not going to be basing our decisions.
And we should have honored their voter intent.
You know what, Joe?
We're not going to base our decisions solely on that information, nor are we going to base our decisions solely on what people say when they come to our doors. We need all the ammo or all of the information or whatever you want to call it in order to make an informed decision how to work with this situation, pro or con, or, you know, I can see it going either direction, but I need information. Well, it's a feeling for you, and I understand that.
I think the one thing that we need to be careful of as council members is to not weight whatever you find out at the meeting more than we weight what we find out from our constituents. And I personally believe that it is each one of our responsibilities, what everybody else does here, that is their choice. But I feel compelled to talk to my constituents wherever. I mean, people have showed up for coffee, even after the meeting, concerned about what's going to happen. I'm sure that you're probably going to get some of those people attending your meeting as well. But I think we need to be careful, too, that you're not necessarily the representative of council. Other information, and so, but I think we need to be careful and decide how would we weight the information that you find out also, because that's another decision that we would have to make.
Thank you for that. I think that's the point I was trying to make, is that, you know, we need to weight this appropriately. Any other comments or questions?
When we went out for the community meetings, then the next up Inglewood, and they said, in the map, I know you like your neighborhood, but in the map, if we were going to put in townhomes, where would it be? Then it's like, no place. We weren't considering townhomes. We weren't considering apartments. We weren't considering any. So when people, when I was sitting next to people and I went to three of those meetings, I would have gone to all of them if they didn't hold them at the same time, they said they've already decided. They're already going to put townhomes, and now I'm just trying to hold, push back. So if you start asking questions like that, if it goes through, how far do you want it to be? If it goes through, if this becomes, and I'm just afraid that it's going to already be that. And it's not a trust issue for staff. It is that it's not an, I just truly don't think it's an appropriate thing for you to do. I saw the pushback that we got just from doing the next step, Inglewood, where they go, it's just a dog and pony show. They're just doing this and they've already decided. And I'm afraid that's going to be the same kind of feel. I'm all for talking to as many people. We had the town halls. We're having this input in there. And the other thing is that I appreciate that. I believe that it comes from your heart, that you go, hey, council's got a problem. They need to get input here, and I want to help them. But that should have happened with us first before you started with her first. We were able to put a town hall together fairly quickly, and I think that council has to play a role in this, or it starts to look like the dog is, the tail's wagging the dog here. It is not, I don't believe you were disingenuous in wanting to do this. It's not a trust issue. It is my job. I was elected by people to represent them, not to send you out and go get their temperature. I just don't think that that's your job. So it's not a trust issue. I think you're very competent, very capable, and I think your heart was in the right place in wanting to do this. But the information that you bring back, I'm not sure is going to be worth the time and effort of you doing this outside of council, holding town halls, or being participative in that piece of it. I just don't think it's going to be.
Thank you for that. We heard your comments there, Steve, and then we'll wrap this up.
excuse me. I think at this moment we have a consensus for staff to go out there, and it's just the way it is. And I understand everybody's concerns, and what can I say?
Let's move forward.
We need data.
Amen. And so, you know, you hear what the consensus of council is to move forward with this. Anything else, sir?
No, sir.
Thank you. City Attorney report?
Yes, you do. I was promised that you did, and I need my tree update. I was promised in the memo that you were going to bring it up. You said you were working on it when I asked, and you're going to have to give me the update on it.
Hang on, right now.
Yeah,
like it'll come forward next week.
I'll forward the email on to you, but I was...
In the next couple of weeks, it sounds like it'll be coming forward in the next couple of weeks.
This is going on 6 weeks. That's a little much for
anything,
something...